Good afternoon. You don't always have to worry about people after lunch. They get the siesta thing. You know. Welcome to the 34th celebration of the Congressional Art Competition. My name is Mark Strand, and I'm the president of the Congressional Institute. And our institute is proud to sponsor the Congressional Art Competition. This is the 11th year we've been involved in it, even though it's been going on for 34 years. From the beginning of our republic, our leaders have understood the importance of art. George Washington himself wrote that to encourage literature and arts is a duty which every good citizen owes his country. Well, over two centuries later, you, the winners of the 2015 Congressional Art Competition, take your place among the good citizens who have enriched our country with your art. We could not be happier to recognize your talents and your contributions to American culture. It's important to put in perspective just what an honor the country is bestowing on you by having your pictures hang in the Capitol for a year. Even each state is only allowed two statues, and any other work of art must be approved by an act of Congress. So this is an honor not to be taken lightly, to have your works hanging with the other artwork here in the Capitol. Now, besides the millions of visitors to our Capitol who will see your artwork, think of it as a great museum, millions of people, the House of Representatives will run an online gallery of your paintings on the front page of the House's website, which is visited by over 10 million people every year. So there are going to be a lot of people seeing your work. And it's a great opportunity for the country to celebrate your art. I want to thank them, the people who make the exhibit of your artwork possible. The curator of the Capitol, Dr. Barbara Wolanin, and her staff have the monumental task of caring for and hanging the artwork. For those of you who've seen that, out in the hall, you realize just what a big job that is. Also, Mr. Stephen Ayers, the architect of the Capitol, and William Wotermer, the House superintendent, and their staff have been tremendously helpful in preparing the exhibit as well. This year is the best participation level we've ever had. Out of the 441 offices in the House, 427 have participated and are represented here today. This massive undertaking does not happen without the hard work by a lot of people, so I do want to mention some of them. Andrew Griffin and Aaron Wilson from Congressman Glenn Thompson's office, and Bradley Solin from Representative Lois Franklin's office have done tremendous work. I've been very effective at organizing this program. I would also like to thank Jennifer Modaleski and Andrew Meyer of the Congressional Institute. But most importantly, I want to thank Tim Lang of the Congressional Institute, who has put in countless hours of hard work to make this day possible. He's been at the center of this project, coordinating with each congressional office, contacting each artist's family, each office, putting this all together. Tim's done a great job, and we couldn't have done this without him. So a big round of applause for Tim Lang. It's also his birthday tomorrow, so if you want to say happy birthday to him. Yeah, I stand in awe of your talent and your courage in putting your art before the nation. The great poet Robert Frost once said that artists are always believers ahead of your evidence. He said, what was the evidence that I could write a poem? I just believed it. The most creative thing in us is to believe art into existence. So thank you for believing your art into existence. On behalf of all those involved in this project, congratulations for being a winner of the 2015 Congressional Art Competition. I'm telling you, after lunch speaking, so I just think, no. there are a lot of other people who make this possible, some of the companies and education institutions involved. I want to ask Dan Hinson of Southwest Airlines to come here. Southwest Airlines has made it possible for many of you to come here. And thanks to their help over the years, a whole bunch of students get to come to Washington that otherwise might not be able to. Dan began his career in public service, working in foreign affairs for the U.S. Department of State. There he served as a staff associate and communications liaison for Special Representative Rita Lewis and under Secretary Clinton and Kerry. From there, he went to the United States mission at the UN, working under U.S. Ambassador Samantha Power. He is now applying his many talents to the private sector. Please welcome Dan Hinson with Southwest Airlines.
Thank Thank you. That was such a kind welcome. Thank you, Mark. And good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to our nation's capital. I have to tell you that I'm tremendously impressed with the caliber of work that I saw this year. So you all have really accomplished something meaningful. And on behalf of Southwest Airlines, I want to extend our sincerest congratulations as you join this elite group of young artists whose artwork adorns the walls of our nation's capital. For the next year, your artwork will be admired by members of Congress and citizens alike as they walk these halls of our nation's most treasured building. As Mark mentioned, I had the distinct pleasure of serving in the public sector and working and living in DC for several years, and I have to tell you that it's one of my favorite places in the world. But on this occasion, I'm actually reminded of a story told to me by a dear friend and a predecessor of mine in this role, Monica Del Rio. After Monica graduated from college, she had the privilege of working as a congressional intern, and one of her main duties as an intern was to give tours of the Capitol building where we all sit right now. And so she told me that they always began the tour the same way, and it was in the hallway where your artwork now hangs. And it was one of her favorite parts of the tour and one of my personal favorite parts as a participant in the tour, as the constituents would slow their pace to enjoy the outstanding artwork in front of them with many comments and questions. And you should all take great pride in knowing that at any given point in the day for the next year, that your artwork is being discussed and admired by people from all walks of life, from all over the country, and from all over the world. So for the 14th consecutive year, Southwest Airlines has exhibited its continued commitment to the arts through our support of the Congressional Art Competition, and we are extremely grateful for all of your support and our continued participation with the Congressional Art Competition, and we're also so deeply pleased to partner with our 2015 co-chairs, Representatives Thompson and Frankel, as we know they recognize the value of art in the lives of our country's young people the same way that Southwest does. So we are truly honored to be with you here today, and we look forward to seeing some of your artwork hanging one day, maybe on the walls of the Guggenheim, the Met, or the Louvre. But congratulations to you all, sincerely, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your time here in DC.
Well, it's gonna have to wait a year before it hangs in the Louvre, because it has to stay here first. Our next speaker is with Adobe, and they have made a very generous offer to all the winners of the contribution, which Lisa will tell you about. Lisa is a government relations manager at Adobe, a position she's held since June of 2011. She works and she advocates on behalf of Adobe here on the government. Prior to this, Lisa worked at the Congressional and Public Affairs of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and she's worked on international trade issues, so if you get tired of talking about art and you want to ask her about the trade agreement, you can. She does double duty. She's a graduate from Northwestern University, where she majored in political science, which it's liberal art, but it's kind of an art thing. Okay, not exactly. She earned a master's degree in international economics and international relations from the Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies, and an MBA from Columbia University. And she's born and raised in Minnesota. She worked and studied in Chicago, New York, Paris, Brussels, and Washington, D.C. Please welcome Lisa Lindgren.
So I just want to point out that even those of us who studied political science are also creative. Maybe we're not great at creating artwork all the time, but we can use our creativity in other ways. So, thank you so much for welcoming Adobe to participate in the Congressional Art Competition recognition ceremony this afternoon. It's great to see all of you out there, and we really appreciate the support of the Congressional Institute, as well as the co-chairs of the competition this year. This is Adobe's third year working with the Congressional Institute, and I have to say that every year I'm increasingly impressed with the amazing artwork that all of you are submitting to the competition. Like some of the other speakers have said already, I think everyone who comes to DC and has the chance to stop by the Capitol really admires all of the artwork that's hanging in the Capitol tunnel. You know, it's something I always point out, and any chance I have to take a little detour, stop by to see what all of you have in the tunnel. Congratulations on winning the competitions in your congressional districts. I hope that you enjoy the time that you have out here to see as much of the nation's capital as you can while you're visiting. There's so many great things to see in DC. Many of them are free, so enjoy this beautiful day, take a walk along the mall, stop in some of the museums, and just really realize that you're in a cool place here as you look at the Capitol on one side and the Washington Monument and the Lincoln Memorial. So some of you might have submitted paintings or drawings for this year's Congressional Art Competition, but just by a show of hands, I'm wondering how many of you have worked with Adobe products in the past? All right. So how many of you are familiar with the Adobe Creative Cloud or some of our products like Adobe Photoshop or Adobe Premiere? All right. Looks like most of the students here are familiar with those. Did you know that Adobe has actually been around as long as the Congressional Art Competition? So that goes back well before any of you were born to 1982. And this is actually the 25th anniversary for Adobe Photoshop as well. I'm excited to let all of the student winners know that in the next couple of months, you'll be receiving an email that provides details on how to redeem your very own subscriptions of the Adobe Creative Cloud. The subscription will be available to you for an entire year and will provide you with the most updated features for your favorite tools that are accessible both on your desktop and also on your mobile devices. We just released the 2015 Creative Cloud, so there are plenty of new items for you to explore on there as well. At Adobe, we can't wait to see what our tools can help you make and create. We recognize the importance of having a creative outlet while you're in school and also for your endeavors after graduation. Congratulations again on this spectacular achievement. And if you have questions following the program, I'll be out in the hallway, so feel free to stop by. I think I have a few more Adobe pens, too, if you weren't able to get one already. All right, thank you.
One of the great things, too, is that we have now two schools, and more growing, I think, in the future, who are interested in helping students who are winners of the Congressional Art Competition. Now, this always tends to attract the attention of the parents a lot more than the students, because they're the ones looking ahead at the financial obligations, but it's a great opportunity. The first person I'd like to introduce is Emilio Reyes LeBlanc. He's with Savannah College of Art and Design. Emilio Reyes LeBlanc leads admission operations and recruitment strategy for the largest not-for-profit art and design university in the country, the Savannah College of Art and Design. With campuses on three continents, in Savannah, Atlanta, Hong Kong, and Lacoste, France, and 20% of their incoming class enrolling from international markets, SCAD has one of the most international schools of its kind. This year, the school has received over 17,000 applications for fall 2015, and they're expecting an incoming class of 3,600 students. Throughout his career in higher education, Emilio has participated in a wide variety of community education events, ranging from participating in the Scholastic Art Awards to presenting on portfolio preparation across the country. His team of over 30 recruiters visited over 4,000 unique schools this season, and it's with great pleasure that he wraps up the recruitment year at the Congressional Art Competition. Please join me in welcoming Emilio Reyes LeBlanc.
Hi. My name is Emilio Reyes LeBlanc, and it's my pleasure to be here at Congressional Arts on behalf of Savannah College of Art and Design. Savannah College of Art and Design extends its regards and recognizes you for this amazing achievement in being featured at Congress with Congressional Arts. Every year at SCAD, we enroll people who've participated in this, and over the past couple of decades, we've had literally dozens of people come to SCAD through Congressional Arts. So we're proud to be a great sponsor and partner with this wonderful organization. SCAD is one of the premier providers of art and design education in the United States. As Mark mentioned, we have campuses in Savannah, Georgia, where I'm based, Atlanta, Hong Kong, and Lacoste, France, as well as study online. We have over 11,000 students across all those different locations. And what we offer is a kind of education with wonderful professionals who have wonderful credentials and have wonderful industry experience. And we have a positively oriented university environment that really creates a wonderful synthesis of different variables that make our student experience so great. The education and career preparation of each SCAD student is nurtured and cultivated by faculty with wonderful credentials, as I mentioned, and through individual attention in an inspiring university environment, as well as professional level technology. We have a partnership with Adobe, for instance, equipment and learning resources. We provide an exceptional education and unparalleled career preparation. Ancient Greek physician Hippocrates said, vita brevis, ars longus, which is life is short, but art is long. So on behalf of SCAD, I'd like to congratulate you on your universally everlasting contributions through art. Congratulations.
Joining us this year in the program is Tennessee Wesleyan College. Julie Jack is a tenured full professor of art at Tennessee Wesleyan College, where she has been instrumental in developing the art curriculum, the fine arts major, and the visual arts studios. She earned her BFA at the Middle Tennessee State University and her MFA at the School of Art Institute of Chicago, where also there she was awarded the honors of graduate and teaching assistantships. Since then, Julie Jack has been head of the Visual Arts Department, teaching Foundation's art courses, traveled extensively with students, visiting museums and galleries throughout the United States and Europe. She has published and has received numerous grants to benefit her institution and her students, including a sizable grant from the Mellon Foundation. In addition, Ms. Jack is a productive visual artist, exhibiting nationally and creating an art that melds her understanding of contemporary issues with her Tennessee roots. Please join me in welcoming Professor Julie Jack.
Thank you, Mark. Congressional members, if you're here, artists and guests, welcome. Tennessee Wesleyan is pleased to be a part of this year. We're offering a $3,000 scholarship to each of you, being first place winners. You're outstanding artists, and you're going to enjoy this slideshow that you're about to see. We saw it earlier this morning, and it's really impressive. So, we would like to invite you to be a part of Tennessee Wesleyan's family and come to Athens, Tennessee, and see what we're up to. We're located between Knoxville and Chattanooga. I described earlier that if you want to imagine, you know, Dolly Parton, right? And the Chattanooga Choo Choo. So we're between, you see where I'm going with that, Dollywood and the Chattanooga Choo Choo. We're the navel. If it's a figurative study, we're kind of the navel. But anyway, we're there. And then we're between Asheville and Nashville, Atlanta, and the Blue Moon of Kentucky. So we're a little town. We're sort of like Mayberry. And we're also a little family. So if you want to study in a small environment where you have a lot of one-on-one, we would be a good place for you to come. Also, you have that access to larger cities as well as the comfort and protection safety of a small town. But mostly, we would like to just congratulate you and hopefully you'll enjoy the rest of your day. And thanks again.
One of the great things about the Congressional Art Competition is that, you know, you hear all the talk about Congress not getting along. Well, it's one of the most bipartisan things that Congress does. And every year there are two co-chairs from each party who head up the whole process, the celebration. And we're fortunate to have both of them with us here today. The first one is Lois Frankel from Florida. After serving 14 years in the Florida State Legislature, including as the first woman Democratic minority leader, Lois Frankel became mayor of West Palm Beach in 2003. Congresswoman Frankel was elected in 2012 to represent Florida's 22nd congressional district, which stretches from Riviera Beach in Palm Beach County to Fort Lauderdale and Plantation in Broward County. She is the first woman to represent Florida's 22nd Congressional District. Congresswoman Frankel serves on the Transportation Infrastructure and the Foreign Affairs Committee. On the Transportation Infrastructure Committee, she sits on the Highways and Transit, Water Resources and Environment in the Coast Guard and Maritime and Transportation Subcommittees. And she sits on the Foreign Affairs Committee, where she serves in the Middle East and North Africa Subcommittee. But one of the most interesting things about Congresswoman Frankel is she's also an artist herself. Without further ado, please welcome Congresswoman Lois Frankel.
How are you going to be? We're going to have a show and tell. Well, good afternoon. Are you having a great time in Washington? How many of you is the first time here? Oh, wow. Well, welcome. So, let me start off. I want to thank, did you get to meet our sponsors yet? Did they come up here yet? Okay, good. Well, let me thank the sponsors of the competition. I want to thank our parents and teachers, and of course, a big congratulations to all the students. It's very inspiring to see so much young talent here from all over the country. And I'm very happy to co-chair the art competition this year with my colleague and friend, Congressman Glenn Thompson, and he'll come out here in a minute. As mentioned, I represent beautiful the southeast coast of Florida, and we're well known for our beaches and our palm trees, but we have lots of great arts and culture. And one of the reasons I'm so excited to be in a room full of so many artists is because I love art, and I always have. And when I think back to when I was in school, I was a pretty good student, but when I got up every day, the reason I wanted to go to school was for my art classes and my gym classes. And that's what got me there. And you know, it's interesting. After I left high school, and I got, you know, I went on to Boston University, then I went on to study law. Art sort of got away from me, except I found myself, when I would be in meetings, I would start to doodle. And they were piling up. I got into the state legislature, and you know, after a while, you're listening to the same thing over and over, and the doodles are piling up. And then when I was age 50, a friend said to me, "Well, put your doodles on canvas." And there's one of my doodles right there. Hey, listen, it's not as cool as most of the artwork I've seen now that you have hanging up in our Capitol, but I will tell this, I can understand the passion and just the great feeling of being able to be creative. But you know, art is much more than that. It is, it's a critical aspect of our common human experience. And you know what, it doesn't matter where you're from or what language you speak or your religion or your race, when you are in front of a painting or a photograph or a sculpture, none of that makes a difference. Great example, Mona Lisa. 9 million people a year go see Mona Lisa. Well, guess what, kids? You're going to get close to that because you're going to have thousands and thousands of people walking up and down in this Capitol looking at your art. And I think that's pretty awesome. Art also outlives us all, and it is really memorializes in a lot of ways who we are and what we were. Start going back to the cave people up until today and then into the future. And not only does it tell our history, but art and culture drives our economy. Over $700 billion a year in economic value for arts and culture in the United States. So that's why this competition is so relevant and so important, bringing young people in. And you all are blessed because today in this country, 40% of our students don't have any access to the arts. Now, isn't that wrong? It really is. So I'm glad that you all are blessed having teachers and parents who have nurtured you to get you here today. So I'm going to congratulate you all again. If you come by my office, I'm in Longworth 1037. This character has lots of brothers and sisters, and you can see the wacky mind of a congresswoman. But anyway, congratulations again to all of you, and have a wonderful day. And you're going to bring out Glenn, or am I going to bring out Glenn? You're going to bring out Glenn, or I'm going to bring out Glenn? Okay. Congratulations again. Take care.
All right, the other member of Congress who's a co-chair of the Congressional Art Competition is Glenn Thompson of Pennsylvania. He was first elected to represent Pennsylvania's 5th District in the House of Representatives in 2008. Prior to being elected to Pennsylvania's geographically largest congressional district, Congressman Thompson spent 28 years as a therapist, a rehabilitation services manager, and a licensed nursing home administrator. He's a 30-plus year veteran of the Boy Scouts. Congressman Thompson has served as a scoutmaster, council executive, board member, and council president. And among just 2,000 presented since 1969, in 2012, Glenn Thompson received the National Distinguished Eagle Scout Award. So he spent a lot of time working with kids. He serves on 3 committees, which is unusual here in the House. Normally, members only are limited to 2. He's on the House Agriculture Committee, the Natural Resources Committee, and the Education and Workforce Committee. Congressman Thompson is serving his 3rd term as the chairman of the House Agriculture Subcommittee on Conservation and Forestry. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Glenn Thompson.
Mark, thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. And welcome to Washington. And congratulations. Congratulations on being here. You know, we've been doing this since 1982. There's been about 650,000 participants in the overall program, but you are among a very small few that have come to be in this place on Capitol Hill because of your sharing your gifts, sharing your talent, and you should be very, very proud. I can tell you on behalf of Congresswoman Frankel, a good friend of mine who I'm so blessed to serve as co-chair nationally for this competition, but really speak on behalf of all 435 members of Congress, just to let you know how each and every one of us is so proud of what you've accomplished and so thankful for your willingness to share your gifts that you have. Your artwork is going to hang. How many of you have seen your artwork already? Excellent. And those who haven't, make sure you got to check it out. You want to get that picture and tweet it out. Let everybody know about this great artwork that we have here. Give you some idea of, in 2012, that was the last number that I was able to find, 18.9 million people visited the U.S. Capitol. So that number is only going up. And so somewhere south, probably north of 20 million people are going to see your artwork. And these are people from, obviously, fellow citizens from this country, but there's people from all over the world to come here. It's one of the number one tourist destinations. And so what a great place of honor to be able to not just recognize and honor your piece of art that you've done, but quite frankly, what a great place to share it with citizens in this country and around the world. You know, the annual art competition is something I always look forward to every spring. And it was my honor to serve as co-chair, national co-chairs this year, from Congresswoman Lois Frankel from the great state of Florida. Just this morning on C-SPAN's Washington Journal, Representative Frankel and I were discussing the importance of this competition and how it encourages our nation's high school students to think creatively and outside of the box. I mean, I have taken your artwork's been up now for, it's been in the process going up for a couple weeks, so I've really taken the opportunity to kind of, when I'm on my way over to votes and coming into the Capitol, to slow down and look at each piece, and wow, some just the talent that you've shared. And I think that among you, there may be some that you wind up at some great universities furthering your studies and in the arts. For others, it would be maybe an avocation. It would be that a gift that you share, that you do. Some professional artists, perhaps, in this group. But I think the value, the overall value of this art competition runs much deeper than that for me. And I think we need to encourage and to develop the arts in our high schools because it does so much more. It encourages artistic expression. It encourages innovation. And those are skills that, you know, I don't care what you do in life. You know, whatever your job or your trade or your profession, whatever your career might wind up being, those who are able to really mobilize and use that artistic expression, that sense of creativity and innovation that you are represented in the pieces of art that you have prepared so skillfully, that'll help you rise to the top. And all those who have participated since 1982 that haven't had their art displayed, they also are benefiting from that exposure to the arts and the encouragement of creativity. Now, I've spoken with many of my colleagues about this year's entries. They're very excited about them. These members of Congress, quite frankly, have been truly blown away by the level of talent that is represented in the halls of the Capitol. Now, this competition, which is sponsored by the Congressional Institute, and I want to thank Mark and his staff. We owe them a debt of gratitude for their leadership and their service with us. How about join me? Help a big hand for the Congressional Institute. As I mentioned, this is the 34th year, I think. I mean, wow! It's what a legacy, and how exciting for you to be a part of that. You've all proven yourselves to be exceptional artists, and you should be excited to be here today and to meet with other students from all across the nation. Your artwork, obviously, is going to be showcased for, I'm estimating, somewhere probably north of greater than 20 million visitors during the year, the 12 months that it will hang in the Capitol. And I want to give certainly a special shout out. I got a chance to, I see him sitting right in the middle of the audience there, a chance to spend some time with him last night. We did a little Capitol tour with Leah Kleiner of Waterford, Pennsylvania, who is here representing the Pennsylvania 5th Congressional District with her mom. We're very proud of her artwork, as we're proud of all of yours. It is, it's now my privilege to introduce this afternoon's keynote speaker, Mr. Perry Winkler. Mr. Winkler is the owner of the beautiful Winkler Gallery of Fine Art located in DuBois, Pennsylvania, which is right in the heart of the Pennsylvania 5th Congressional District. And it's where bring our artwork there we bring in our amateur and professional artists who jury the art. And Perry was born in the mountains of north central Pennsylvania. His first brush to canvas happened before he was 8 years old. His talents and inspiration were fostered into young adulthood, culminating in the 1976 Outstanding Student Artist Award in Jefferson County, Pennsylvania. Now, there's another exciting, constituent that's not maybe not as famous as Perry that lives in Jefferson County. He stands about 3 foot tall. His name's Punxsutawney Phil. Give you some idea where Jefferson County is. Put it on the map for you. You've heard about it before. For Perry, after attending a regional art school, he graduated with an emphasis in graphic arts. Combining this study with his subsequent professional experience in advertising, he greatly refined his abilities for composition and color, and which now mark the genius of his craft. For the past decade, Perry Winkler has worked as a professional artist, producing one-man shows and winning a myriad of awards. And I've seen some of those in the gallery. They're beautiful. During this era, he has also cultivated an impressive style, which is not common to watercolor painting. His style has been touted as being more assertive, utilizing bold colored subjects against lighter backgrounds, rather than the loosely composed, passively colored traditional style. In addition, Mr. Winkler displays a remarkable talent for blending a delicate degree of spontaneity with an artist's concern for detail. And this technique produces images that are both lively and authentic. When he was asked to attribute his success, the answer is simple: perseverance. Add to that the commitment to quality and never compromising the original vision. And after that, the rest will follow. So it's my privilege and my honor to introduce a very accomplished artist. an art advocate, a constituent, and quite frankly, a great friend, Mr. Perry Winkler.
Tell you what, this is so surreal. I feel like I just fell out of a Dolly painting. First of all, I'd like to thank Congressman Thompson for the great introduction, of course, but for giving me this great honor to by asking me to come and share my life experiences as an artist with all of you. And I want to congratulate all of the students on presenting the best of the best and taking first place within your congressional districts. These feathers in your caps that you all have won are you'll carry with you for the rest of your lives. I mean, they can all only serve you well as you enter this information onto your resumes, as you apply for art schools or for jobs in the future. I thought I should let you know that I consider myself to be more of an artist than a public speaker, but I promise to make this as painless as possible. And I felt that the best thing I could do today to start off my speech is to answer a couple of the important questions that I'm sure they're weighing on all of your minds. So the answer to the first question is, yes, Perry Winkler is in fact my real name. I always get asked that all the time. And secondly, no, I'm not related to Fonzie. You know, we all have sort of a story to tell or a memory of when we were first inspired by artwork. When we first had that desire, that drive to become an artist, whether it was through a friend or a family member that would draw, or whether it was through an incredible piece of artwork itself that inspired us. For me, it happened by way of my father. My father was pretty much what we would consider a he-man. He loved hunting and the woods, and he loved my mother and God and country. But he also had a very sensitive side. He loved art and music and made sure that we had those cultural aspects in our lives. We always had music playing, and my father never missed an opportunity to sit down and draw illustrations. And oftentimes it would be for different holidays or different occasions, and sometimes for no reason at all. But one occasion that comes to mind for me that always seems to stand out is when I was about 4 or 5 years old. I remember him coming home from the grocery store, and with him he brought a sheet of what we refer to as butcher paper. Now that's sort of the white sheets of paper that they wrap produce in. And after the groceries were put away, he laid that sheet of paper out on the kitchen table, and he started with a single line sketching. And first he formed this crooked sort of gnarly hand, and then connected to that he was a broomstick. And on top of that broom, he placed a witch, and behind the witch, he placed a full moon. Of course, it was Halloween. Well, I remember being mesmerized and deciding at that early point in my life that that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be able to tell stories, that blank sheet of paper was just, you know, wanting to be drawn on, and I wanted to tell stories in a nonverbal way. When I went on into elementary school, I have to admit I was a little surprised, maybe a little disappointed to find that whenever art class came around on those special days, that the enthusiasm and the excitement that I felt on when I knew that we were going to be working on a project, that excitement wasn't necessarily running through with the rest of my fellow classmates, that a lot of them were actually disappointed that we were going to be doing artwork. And I was also a little surprised, here again, first or second grade, when I realized that not every family had a parent that was doing artwork at home. So I continued on through school, but I have to tell you, when I was in probably second or third grade, I'll never forget one of my teachers sending a note home with my report card stating that, you know, even though my grades were good, she noticed that I had a tendency to stare out the windows and daydream. Well, it's almost 50 years later, and I've decided to take today to clear the air and defend my position. So basically, I wasn't really daydreaming. And granted, I should have probably been paying more attention to math or whatever class was on the board that maybe wasn't quite as relevant to me. But instead, I was staring out the windows, studying the shapes of the birds, how the sunlight fell on them, how they cast shadows on the branches below, and I was always wondering how I would render that in drawing form. Now, if any of you can relate to that frame of mind, well, it's probably because you're part of that quirky sort of minority of people that I refer to as right-brained thinkers. We're no better or worse or less or more than anyone else. We just have a tendency to see the world in probably a little bit of a different light. Well, as I moved on through elementary school and on into middle school, I discovered that within our district that we had recently opened what was known as the DuBois Area Jefferson County Vocational Technical School. Now, just being able to say that, I think we should have been able to be accepted. But in either case, I was anxious to apply because I'd heard that we had something called a graphic arts program. Now, at that early age, I really wasn't even sure what graphic arts meant. All I knew that the word arts was in there, and I felt by getting enrolled that there was a good chance I was going in the right direction. And I was. Probably, I would say, day one or day two, I began to realize that what was meant by graphic arts was more the commercial end of the business. It had to do with layout and design work. It had to do with camera work, you know, running printing presses. And so here again, it wasn't what my ultimate desire was going to be. And part of my speech today is about, you know, not having a tunnel vision and deciding that I want to be a painter and that's what I'm going to do and not keep your mind open to other options. Well, it wasn't long before, I think the early part of 11th grade, that I found that I was able to enroll in our fine art classes. At the Votech School, how our system was set up was that you had your shop class, for me, graphic arts, in half of the day, and the second half of the day, you had your academic classes, whether it was math, algebra, science, and of course, fine art. Well, it just so happened, at that point, our school had recently hired an amazing artist named Patsy Dunmire. Now, Patsy was a very warm soul, very compassionate, and above all that, she was just the most phenomenal artist. She was savvy when it came to painting, pottery, weaving, just all aspects of art. And of course, she had that nurturing nature and never missed an opportunity to get us involved in different programs or in the community or somehow with a project. So I'll never forget going into class one day when Patsy had taken out a sheet of watercolor paper, and in front of her, she had a little still life setup of a simple white vase sitting on a white sheet of paper, and there were a couple stems of daffodils sitting in the vase. And I remember questioning, you know, she's going to paint this in watercolors, how is she going to make that white vase stand out from that white background? Well, Patsy went on to explain to me how with watercolors, when you stare at a sheet of white watercolor paper, what you're seeing is light reflecting off of that surface. And as you lay layers or tints of transparent watercolors onto that paper, what you are then seeing is that white paper reflected through those beautiful colors, which would give watercolor paintings an illuminated look. Well, I automatically was intrigued at this whole theory. And so she started with some generous washes near the bottom of the painting, laying in the shadow patterns of the vase. And before you know it, that white vase against that white background almost began to look three-dimensional. It was almost as if you could lift it off the page. It was by laying in colors behind the white vase and using shadow patterns here again and sunlight, she was able to create that three-dimensional look. Well, then she did something that was kind of interesting. She took a paintbrush and she started painting the green stems of the daffodils. And she worked up to those beautiful yellow petals of the flowers. Well, the next thing she did was really rather profound to me. And it was something that literally sort of made my ideas towards watercolor, the desire and the interest and the direction that I knew I was going to go. She literally changed my life with this next move. She painted in the beautiful yellow petals of the daffodils with bright yellow and orange, but then she took a large brush, a wash brush with just clear water, and started brushing vigorously into the white background all the way around the petals, but she was avoiding touching them. all of a sudden, she pulled that brush full of water over and purposely bumped a couple of the petals. And that beautiful yellow and orange paint all of a sudden dispersed and was bleeding into the background of the paper. Well, even though I was able to appreciate the aesthetic beauty of it all, and I was just like excited to see those colors running and bleeding, I had to question, you know, up until now I was always directed and told to stay within the lines of my drawing, you know, that was how you achieved greatness. And here she was breaking that rule. Well, Patsy went on to explain to me that if you were to take a blank room, just an empty room with nothing in it, and you were to bring an object into it, that it somehow transforms the atmosphere of that room. It has an effect on that room, and that room is no longer the same because of that object being in it. And this was Patsy's way of expressing it. By allowing those colors to bleed beyond the perimeters of the flower, she was allowing that object to affect its surroundings. And that is, in effect, what we do as artists. I mean, we do these paintings, we work on this artwork, we bring them into a room, we hope to affect the atmosphere, and we hope to affect the world and the way people look at the world. So that was one of the more amazing things that happened. Three rather important things happened to me in 11th grade. That was one of them. The second was that Patsy decided at that point that I should probably consider doing something that had never been done at the school before, and that was to have our first one-man art show. So she had me for several months work on a series of watercolor paintings, and after I got a nice body of work together, we decided to hang the first one-man art show at the Votech School. And well, actually, that's me about 30 years ago or 40 years ago, 40 years now. Boy, it's amazing how time is fleeting, and evidently hair is too. Nonetheless, what I discovered by doing the show was I was finally finding my niche. I was finding my voice. And it wasn't long before I started getting all types of compliments from my fellow students, or classmates rather, and from the teachers and the faculty at the school. It was the greatest shot in the arm for someone who sort of struggled with self-esteem issues. I mean, I was never an athlete. I never quite found a niche or a place that I totally fit in. But here I did. So, you know, at that point in my life, that was the greatest shot in the arm that a person could have in 11th grade, or at least so I thought. What happened next was really quite outstanding, and that is that here again, my father, who loved hunting, one day during a hunting excursion at the beginning of winter, I believe it was probably deer season, was out in the woods, and in the woods, he ran into a gentleman who used to originally be from our area, but was now living in Asheville, North Carolina. And my father had known him from years back, but really wasn't familiar with what job or what he was doing at this point in his life. But my dad started explaining to him that for some reason, I didn't seem to share his love for hunting. And he went on to maybe even complain a little bit that all I seemed to have a desire to do was stay at home and paint and draw. And you know, he was right, that was my love, of course. Well, what my dad didn't realize is that George, the man he was talking to, his name was George Gontero, just so happened to be the president of an advertising agency out of Asheville, North Carolina. Now, keep in mind, I was only in 11th grade, and you know, the thought of moving to North Carolina would be like so outrageous at that point. So I wasn't even considering when my dad came home and told me what had happened, you know, talking to George. But my father went on to explain to me that George told him he would like to stop by our house some evening while he was visiting us in our area, and he'd like to take a look at my artwork. I think, you know, George was a rather gracious man, a very talkative person, and very friendly, and I think he felt he'd come by and offer a few words of encouragement to the little country boys, you know, and just sort of be supportive of what I was doing. So, and that's what he did. One evening he came by. But before he got there, I remember dressing up a little bit, probably wearing something a little bit better than what I would normally wear on a weeknight. And I got my portfolio in order, all of the paintings that were in my show. The show was now dismantled, and I had all of that in my portfolio. And George came by, and he started flipping through my portfolio. Now, this man, who was normally really rather talkative, all of a sudden was very quiet. And of course, I was nervous and a little bit excited. and actually getting a little bit disappointed because I was beginning to realize he really wasn't commenting very much. But when he got down to the last two images that he flipped through, he did something rather profound. He looked me in the eye and he made me an offer. He said that when I were to graduate a year and a half later, that I should look him up and consider going to work for him. Well, you know, we as artists were very sensitive types, and I thought, what a gracious offer. You know, he's just, here again, he's just being nice. You know, we notice a lot of times when we show our artwork to people, we get tons of compliments. But I continued on through high school, through the Votech School, here again, every waking moment, going up to Patsy Dunmire's art class and focusing on my shop class. And I have to admit, when I graduated, I didn't immediately take George up on this offer. I had all these negative thoughts, you know, that he probably wasn't sincere or genuine with his offer. And I thought it would be a little embarrassing for me to call him. And first of all, if he told me that he wasn't looking for someone, I would be let down and he would be majorly embarrassed. So I stayed in my little hometown there for a few months before I finally got up the nerve to call him. But when I did, I was just so surprised to find out that yes, he was interested and he was anxious for me to go down and actually become the art director for his advertising agency. Now, this might seem like an outrageous stroke of luck, right? So that's what I did. I held one more art show in my local hometown of Penfield, and I think I sold about $600 worth of paintings. And with that $600 and an old 1972 Pontiac Le Mans, and a back seat full of record albums and a turntable, I took off for North Carolina. And so one of the things that I noticed that was a little bit disappointing to me as I entered Asheville is, first of all, if anyone who here has been there, it's the most beautiful countryside you can imagine, very much like my hometown or the area of our 5th Congressional District in northwestern central Pennsylvania. And I was a little disappointed to see the mountainside all sort of, well, not necessarily cluttered, but more punctuated with all of these advertisements. And I took it upon myself at that point to try to imagine what I could bring to the table that could help me to sort of move beyond this idea that I was contributing to cluttering up the countryside. And I made a commitment at that point that what I was going to do was create colorful and beautiful billboards that would somehow maybe even compliment the countryside. And when I started working for Nagley, that's what I did. And I went through albums and albums of old billboards that other people had done, and I started studying what I could do to strengthen my billboards. And I all of a sudden realized that by taking my subjects and moving them off center, that it somehow making the paintings asymmetrical made them more interesting. I started learning more about proper color combinations and the use of textures and details. Now, billboards have an unusual dynamic in that, from other forms of advertising, in that when people are driving by down the road at 60 miles an hour, there are only a few seconds that they can give that attention to a billboard. So I had to make my images strong and powerful so that my billboards were viewed over the neighboring billboards by our competition. At that point, Nagley Outdoor Advertising, the company that I was working for, had been hiring artists from throughout the region to come in and work on individual projects. And what they were lacking was a sense of continuity or a sense of style or brand, for lack of a better term. And what George felt I could do, or by having their own art department, and this is why I was hired as art director, is that we would start having a common theme and a common vein, and our billboards would have a set style to them. So I discovered, probably during my first year, this would have been 1978, 79, that we had something known as public service billboards. Now, what public service billboards or advertisements are is when, before a billboard is rented out, rather than to have a big blank space on that 14-foot by 48-foot spans of billboard, you could enter positive affirmations, or you could have just artistic images, or you could even enter artwork that would have a political point of view, as long as it was nothing controversial, but just bringing attention to a specific cause. Well, at that point, I know this would have been way before your time, maybe your parents as well, your grandparents might have remembered. In 1979, we were experiencing something called the Iran hostage crisis, where a number of Americans were taken hostage in Iran. And it was a news story, but it wasn't, and you know, you'd hear it for little blurbs every once in a while on the news, but for some reason that story moved me, and I felt that that was going to be the topic for my public service billboard. So the billboard I created simply stated, "Iran, let our people go." And it wasn't necessarily intended to be an artistic billboard, but more or less to get a point across or to create public awareness. My company, unbeknownst to me, decided to take my design and submit it in a national public awareness art competition for advertisers. Well, the reason they didn't tell me, they felt that if I lost, they didn't want to break the news to me, so they entered it, and then they notified me later that I won. So, as a result of winning the contest, my billboard, which, I don't know, maybe some of the more mature members of the audience today might vaguely remember seeing this, but as a result of winning, my billboard went up in cities throughout the United States. And so all of a sudden, instead of my artwork having a voice that was being heard or viewed by 100 or 200 or 300 people at my school, or 1,000 people or more within the city of Asheville, I all of a sudden was communicating an image or a message that was being heard or seen by literally millions of people throughout the country. I'm going to try not to bore you too long with my life story, but there are a couple of things that I felt I really should mention. And that is that one of them is that when I was working for the advertising agency, I went out one night. Remember, it was the 1970s, so disco was in full swing, hence the hair. And but a couple friends of mine decided that we were going to go out partying and dancing one night. And so we went out to a little dance club. And early in the evening, a friend leaned into me and explained to me that a gentleman named Roger Nippris had just entered the club. Well, I had no idea who Roger was. And my friend went on to explain to me that Roger was a very accomplished artist. He was a very successful painter, and that he had quite a following, that he painted in a traditional Renaissance style. And so I wasn't going to leave the club that night until I had the opportunity to meet Roger, and so I sort of prodded my friend and tormented him until he finally took me over to meet Roger. And when Roger and I started talking, it was almost as if the lights went off in the club and the music had stopped. And we were so engaged in a conversation about the theories of art and the business of art. And Roger went on to explain to me that he was starting a series of paintings, large murals for churches. He did a lot of religious work. And he asked if I would consider being a model for him. So I decided I would take him up on the offer because one of the options that he offered me in payment, I could either take cash or I could take the time and modeling and use that to have him do a piece of artwork for me. But the third option, because he knew I was interested in art, was that I could actually apply those hours and towards art classes and go in and work next to Roger, and that's what I did. That was the best option for me. So day after day, when I would leave Nagley Outdoor Advertising, I went and I would pursue my art career, my fine art career. And what I began to realize is that the things that I had been learning or through advertising, moving my subject off center, composition, textures, colors, the importance and significance of creating images that command attention, all of a sudden were affecting my fine artwork. So, but a couple things that I learned that were really important from Roger on a non-technical sense, because if I were to stand here and try to explain to you today all the wonderful things I learned from Roger on a technical level, we would have to rent this place for probably a couple days. But instead, what I chose to share with you are some of the other lessons that I learned from him. One of them was diligence. That whenever, even when you're between projects or you feel uninspired, how important it is to still be drawing and painting and sketching and focusing on your craft, even if you don't feel especially moved by any certain subject. The reason being, as you're continuing working on these little drawings and studies every day, when you are inspired to say something important, you have the skills to do it. Almost as an athlete who, you know, can't one day decide to get up and run a marathon, it's conditioning and it's discipline, and it's staying focused. He also went on to explain certain theories about the company you keep. I mean, I'm sort of going to go off into a bit of a personal realm because, you know, being around negative people, or there are people that will actually pull you away from your desire, and you may not even realize it or see it coming. It can come through the form of a friendship or a personal relationship, but it's important to stay focused and keep your priorities straight. But one of the other really important things that I learned from Roger that I apply to this day, and that is, and I always keep it in the forefront of my mind, is respecting your work. That when you make a presentation, it's important that you present your work as professionally as you can. And Roger, his theory to me was always, how are you going to convince the general public or an art collector or a client that your work has significance or importance if you're not presenting it with that respect yourself? So I noticed when Roger would have clients come over to his house, or to his studio rather, and by the way, Roger's studio was an amazing studio, almost like a warehouse, where it was full of antiques and opera music playing. I mean, it was an experience just to walk into his studio. And whenever clients and customers would come by, he would have his artwork beautifully framed, and they would be sitting on easels, and usually they would be spotlit. And Roger, beyond all of that, demonstrated respect for himself. It was how he carried himself, the way he dressed, the way he spoke, and even more importantly, the way he listened. He listened to his clients, he knew what they wanted, he had a good idea before they left, and they did as well, that he knew exactly what they were looking for. So before I close today, I did want to say, you know, I'm very open to the idea of self-expression and all of that. I wear an earring and all and that type of thing. But you have to keep in mind, as young artists, you're not going to be applying for jobs with other, 18, 20-year-olds. You want to keep in mind that these people that you might be working with are going to be of an earlier generation. They might be in their 30s, 40s, or 50s. And when they're going to invest their hard-earned dollars into hiring someone, chances are they're going to be, and it may sound a little prejudicial to say, well, you know, someone who comes in with flip-flops and torn-up jeans should have the same opportunity as the person who comes in that's dressed well and speaks well. But the fact of the matter is we do make judgment calls, and I know if I were hiring someone, presentation means a lot. So that's just one little point that I wanted to make. Before I close today, I have a short closing statement I'd like to make, but I did want to open the floor if anyone had any questions or any statements that you'd like to make. Yes. Pardon me? That's a great question. He asked, how long does it take for me to complete a piece of work? And I'll give you the answer that Roger used to give to me. You know, I work relatively fast in watercolors. The actual time that I spend sitting and painting on a rather involved piece might be as little as a day, sometimes as many as 3 or 4 days. And I'm talking like morning till night, and oftentimes burning, the midnight oil. But, I might come up with an idea for a painting that I've developed for a long period of time before I even sit down and start at the paper. And as Roger used to say, it's not that time you've spent sitting there painting and producing that piece. It's the 30, 40 years of experience that you've spent developing to get to that point. So I could easily say it took me 2 hours. Roger would say, well, that took you 30 years to paint that painting. So any other questions? Yes. Yes, that's a great question. He asked if I have worked in other medias. I work, when I worked with Roger, I was working exclusively in oils. And that's, I have to say, where my watercolor paintings ended up becoming more detailed and realistic and all of that. I learned through working with Roger, and I still, from time to time, will work in oils and acrylics, and I do murals for restaurants or for any type of business. And I still love pen and ink work. I keep my hands and my skills sort of connected in all different directions. Absolutely. Yes. How do I market and promote my art? You know, that's another terrific question. You know, the art business, I was just explaining to someone earlier, is much more abstract than any other type of business. You know, if you're going to be a doctor, you go to college, you know, you do an internship, you apply for work. The art business is much more abstract. For me, it just sort of happened because of my love for it. But I keep my options open. I mean, don't be afraid to go to the local restaurants, go to the successful restaurants, don't go to the little greasy spoon diner down the road, but go to the places where, you know, they're not going to charge you a high commission, where probably the more refined restaurants, where the type of client you're wanting to connect with. And most times, they're anxious to have work or be happy to represent artists. And so I do restaurants, hotels, galleries. Of course, we have the Winkler Gallery and Art Education Center in DuBois now. But in Asheville, North Carolina, I sell through a number of restaurants and hotels. And I also market through a lot of the competitions that I enter. So. You know, that sort of touches on something else. You know, as an artist, you'll find, you know, it's a very competitive field, and I find that there's an importance to diversify. I have, over the past few years, I released greeting cards, limited edition prints. I recently published, actually what you're seeing right now, A Homeward Glance, which is a large limited edition coffee table book. They're all hand numbered and signed. So, you know, we have very creative minds. And don't let that negative, you know, voice in the back of your mind say, well, this is, you know, too outrageous for me to do. If it's outrageous, you know, that's a good indication that maybe you should explore that route, because other people probably aren't doing that. So it's through teaching and my students and through word of mouth has a lot to do with my marketing skills. But here again, don't be, you know, don't close yourself off to the idea of people are afraid to do pet portraits or house portraits. You know, we sometimes feel like we're selling out, but if you take on those subjects, you can take it as a challenge and say, how can I do this in an artistic way where this painting is going to have merit rather than just being a standard portrait? So keep your options open and use your creative minds for that. Pardon me? Do I teach online? You know, that's venue I've been sort of considering lately. You know, we see a lot of times there are these painting a day classes where people can go on, and I've recently been speaking with some people that are into filming and recording, and they've been strongly recommending it. And I do a lot of demonstrations like that I can complete within an hour or two. I do a lot of what we call paint and pour events where people come and drink wine throughout the evening while they're painting, but it's been suggested so often, and I believe that'll probably be the next step for me. Yeah. Yes. Pricing your artwork. Now, there's a touchy subject. I have to tell you, this all comes back to the idea of respecting your work. We have people that sometimes feel, well, I'm going to do, you know, 100 paintings this year, and I'm going to sell them for $45 each, and, you know, I'm going to move that artwork, and that's going to help me to survive. But, you know, here again, you have to keep in mind the hours and the time that you spent developing that craft. I'm always a strong advocate for even the members of our gallery to not sell out, to not go too cheap. You know, what you do is a very specialized thing. If you were spending that time as a doctor, think of the what you would be, you know, charging for that artwork. And what a lot of young artists don't realize is when you start establishing yourself as someone who does $100 or $200 paintings, you're eliminating a whole group of collectors, the people that want to invest in artists that are going places. And they oftentimes, no matter how good the artwork is, will overlook a painting that you're selling for $100 or $200, and they'll look at the artist's work a little more seriously that's charging maybe $1,000 or $2,000. As a matter of fact, a general rule of thumb for me that I've discovered, and I've actually read this and had some doubts over it in the past, is that true collectors really don't look seriously at artwork until they see a price tag of about $2,000 on it. That's a good indication that that artist is going places. So, yep, you're welcome. Yes.
As an artist, how do you stay with inspiration? How do you know what you're going to do next?
Andrew Wyeth, who is someone that I've always admired his work, and I remember someone asked him before he passed away, what is his greatest painting of all time? And he said, it's always the one I'm working on now. Inspiration to me comes from an outside source. It's something that moves me. I never really know what's to come down the road. And as you can see with my artwork, I've never been one of these cookie cutter painters who comes up with a set theme or a vein. And, for me, that would be almost claustrophobic.